On today's program, Jonathan Burness talks about Romans 11:11 and the responsibility of the Gentiles to provoke the Jewish people to jealousy.
That Jewish co-worker, that Jewish neighbor, that Jewish acquaintance is not there by accident. God wants you to be a light to them.
And then David Brickner and Susan Perlman with Jews for Jesus share techniques on how to witness to Jewish people.
Look for an opportunity to share how God is real in your life. You don't have to tell a story about salvation even. How about just answered prayer? How about how God has been with you through the difficult times?
Shalom and welcome to Jewish Voice, a program to help you discover the Jewish roots of your faith and grow in your knowledge of God and His Word. As believers in Jesus, the roots of your faith are Jewish. Jesus Himself was Jewish, and so were all His first followers. You know, when you begin to discover the Jewish dimension, the Hebraic worldview, the incredible relationship between the Old Testament and the New Testament scriptures, it will completely open your eyes to so much more. It's a revelation that can literally transform your relationship with the Lord. Here at Jewish Voice, we're privileged to present Yeshua. That's the given name for Jesus, and it means salvation in Hebrew to both Jewish people and the nations. In fact, through our outreaches to some of the remotest places on earth, places like Ethiopia and Northwest India, we're seeing literally thousands of Jewish people coming to know Jesus as their Messiah. But what about America? Are Jewish people in America open to the gospel? Well, many would say no, but in fact, many really are. Most of you watching today know someone Jewish, and you may be wondering, how can I share my faith with them? What do I say? Well, that's exactly what we'll be exploring today. I'm going to be clearing up some of the misconceptions that you may have about Jewish people a little later on in the program. But first, I want you to meet two experts on this important topic. They lead what's probably the best-known Jewish evangelistic ministry in the world. With branches in 13 countries, Jews for Jesus is known for its forthright approach to presenting Jesus in major Jewish population centers around the world. David Brickner is the executive director of Jews for Jesus, and he's appeared on many secular radio and television programs to defend his faith as a Jewish believer in Jesus. Susan Perlman is director of communications for Jews for Jesus, and she's been with the organization since 1972. Please welcome to Jewish Voice, David Brickner and Sue Perlman. Welcome. Great to have you on the program. Hi, David.
Hi, Jonathan.
Have a seat. Well, thank you both for coming. It's a pleasure to have you. We have dedicated these next 2 months of the ministry, both in our magazine, our television program, other communication vehicles, to reaching the world's largest Jewish population. And many don't realize that the largest Jewish population is the United States. And we have featured in this issue, Susan, a typical Jewish American girl. So congratulations. That's you. It's a great article. Reaching the world's largest Jewish population. Talk about the typical Jewish American girl growing up, will you, Susan?
Well, I think I don't know if I was typical, but I certainly grew up in an American home that was Jewish. I mean, my parents were first generation Americans themselves. Grandparents came from the old country, Russia, Poland.
So many of us, Poland.
Exactly.
For me.
and I was always very proud of being a Jew. It was, you know, my heritage, who I was. And of course, part of being Jewish meant not believing in Jesus. That was just a given. You know.
So Jesus was just their God, right?
Their God.
The other God.
The God of the Gentiles.
Now, David, you have a very unique testimony because unlike most of us that are first generation Messianic Jews, you're fifth generation Messianic Jew.
That's right.
That may be a record. I don't know.
It is the oldest lineage of Jewish believers in Jesus that we know of.
My great-great-grandfather was the chief rabbi of the Hasidic Jews of Zhytomyr in the Ukraine. Back in the 1800s, wow. His wife, the Rebbetzin, became a follower of Jesus. Now, you think that Jews for Jesus raises eyebrows today. Can you imagine the wife of the chief Hasidic Rebbe of Zhytomyr coming to faith?
She had to be disdained, ostracized.
She was, and her children all became followers of Jesus and likewise experienced a lot of persecution. And it's an amazing story of how they made it from the Ukraine, pogroms, persecution, through London, England, to Toronto, where my mother was born. And so that's the five generations.
Hey, we got to take a break. When we come back, we're going to talk not only about how David and Susan became part of Jews for Jesus, and they were called by God to go back to their own people, but we're going to talk about how to reach your Jewish friend or coworker or neighbor. They're not in your life by accident. There's much more to come. Don't go away.
These are the people that Jonathan Bernis and Jewish Voice are reaching by the thousands with desperately needed medical care and the good news of the gospel of Yeshua. And now you can do your part in reaching the largest population of Jewish people in the world, the American Jews. Do you know that believers are commanded to share the good news of salvation with the Jewish people? For your gift of $50 or more, Jonathan Bernis would like to send you his Jewish Outreach Kit, which will enable you to effectively share the gospel with your Jewish friend or neighbor. First, you will receive Jonathan's book on how to share Yeshua. In this book, Jonathan reveals the exciting revelation of God's call to share his son with the children of Abraham. Call now and you will also receive Jonathan's DVD on the 10 biggest lies about Jesus and his Jewishness, and a copy of A Rabbi Looks at Jesus of Nazareth. With warmth and transparency, Jonathan shares his journey of discovering Jesus and how it changed his life. Finally, for your gift of $50 or more, you will receive Moish and Seal Rosen's book, Witnessing to Jews, Practical Ways to Relate the Love of Jesus. Jews for Jesus founder Moish Rosen wrote this essential guide for witnessing to the Jewish people. So please pick up your phone or go online and give your most generous gift today.
Welcome back to Jewish Voice. I'm Jonathan Bernis. Well, if you're just joining us, we're talking with two leaders of Jews for Jesus, David Brickner and Susan Perlman, and you were both sharing very different backgrounds. Susan, you came from a typical Jewish family, or a typical American Jewish girl, according to the article, who understood that Jesus was the God of the Christians. But David, you have a very unique testimony because you're fifth generation Messianic Jewish.
That's right.
I don't even know how to pronounce that exactly.
Well, you know, Romans 11, verse 5, Paul says, there is therefore a remnant to this very day according to God's gracious choice. So I'm living proof of the promise that God has to keep a remnant of Jewish followers of Jesus all the way from 2,000 years ago till today.
David, I want you to address the question that some people watching may be thinking, how can you believe in Jesus and retain all of these Jewish things? How can you believe in grace and the law at the same time? I'm sure you've heard that.
Absolutely. If someone told me, because you're a follower of Jesus, you can't celebrate the Passover, that would be a kind of reverse legalism, a Phariseeism that comes from a different angle. And so we're free to observe or not, and we're not brought under the law, so to speak. We're under grace. But the law was a schoolmaster to bring us to the Messiah, and it has the richness of God's character revealed through all of the festivals and through all of the commandments. We can't keep the commandments. There's some 613 of them, and a majority of them had to do with what you had to do in the temple. So the temple is not existing anymore. So we have a wonderful, grace-filled Jewish life.
Can I comment on something that David said?
Go for it.
Would that be all right? Because, you know, he actually is a great example to answer the charge that we often get that, well, when you become a Jewish believer in Yeshua, you're no longer Jewish, and you're a threat to the survival of Jewish people. Here he is, a fifth generation Jewish believer in Jesus, still retaining his Jewish identity, passing it on to his children. And, you know, and to me, I think that's a great testimony to the fact that we're not less Jewish and we're not abandoning our Jewishness by becoming followers of Jesus. We're really fulfilling it.
I'm going to say amen to that. That is exactly right. You're living proof that this is not about assimilation.
Jesus made us kosher.
Yes, indeed. You're doing so much worldwide, and I've been involved in the ministry for many, many years. This next couple of months, we're focusing on reaching Jewish people here at home, here in America. And most Jewish people have come to the Lord through the testimony of a Christian friend. That's what happened to me. A Christian cared enough about me to tell me the truth. That's what you found with Jewish believers?
Absolutely, in some very dramatic ways. One time I was handing out tracts on the corner of 34th and Broadway, Macy's, and a woman approached me, well-dressed woman in her late 60s, and she was angry, and she began to yell at me and say, "How can you do this? You should be ashamed of yourself. Do you know what you're doing? Does your mother know you're doing this?" And then she showed me numbers on her arm. So you see, Ruth is a survivor of Auschwitz, the Holocaust, and there was very little that I could say to her that day. But what I didn't know was that her Italian-American doorman outside of her apartment was being a faithful witness, and he brought her 2 months later to the Jews for Jesus office there in New York. And, yeah. They walk in while I'm in the middle of giving the message, and I recognized her right away, but I couldn't quite place where we had met. So after the service, I approached her, and she reminded me where we had met. So I said, "What are you doing here?" She said, "I've got an open mind." What a change. But you know what made that difference was during that interim, here's this Italian, American, you know, doorman who loved Jesus and loved Ruth and just shared that love with her and then brought her to where she could hear a distinctive Jewish testimony. And, you know, Ruth kept coming back every Friday night, started coming to her Tuesday night Bible studies. And it was a privilege for me one Friday night to pray with Ruth to receive Jesus as her Messiah.
That's awesome. Awesome.
Hallelujah.
I've seen so many Jewish people that really get angry right before they get pulled into the net. I'd much rather see a Jewish person respond with anger than indifference.
Absolutely.
And I'm sure you feel the same way. Susan, can you talk a little bit about the hostility that I'm sure some Christians that have shared their faith have received from Jewish people? Where does that come from?
Well, I mean, I think oftentimes, you know, it's almost a knee-jerk reaction. It's not really thought through. It's not logical. Because, I mean, there are so many Christians that have shown a great deal of love and appreciation for Jewish people because they love Jesus. You know, the Corrie Ten Booms, the Dietrich Bonhoeffers. I mean, there are wonderful stories of Christians who have really, you know, shared their faith in very dramatic ways. But one of the interesting things for me to see is the kind of responses we get, both positive and negative, through the internet these days. And we have a pretty big presence on Facebook, and we do a lot of YouTube videos, and we're followed on Twitter, and some of those comments are you know, nasty, and some of them are nice, but they all provide an opportunity, a platform for us to respond and to interact and engage with this next generation who are seeking and searching for answers.
I think that there's many people, well, I know there's many people watching the program, love the Jewish people, have a Jewish friend, coworker, acquaintance, don't know where to begin. A lot of misconceptions. Where do they begin, David?
Friendship. Friendship is a good foundation for any kind of a witness. And when you establish that you really care about this person, and you know that they're Jewish, and you appreciate their Jewish identity, you can do that in so many different ways. Send a Hanukkah card instead of a Christmas card. You're letting your Jewish friend know that you really appreciate their Jewish identity, and then look for opportunities to steer the conversation towards spiritual matters. Ask leading questions. Look for an opportunity to share how God is real in your life. You don't have to tell a story about salvation even. How about just answered prayer? How about how God has been with you through the difficult times? Because you see, Paul tells us that salvation has come to the Gentiles in order to provoke Israel to jealousy. Your Jewish friend may have a rich heritage, but they don't have a relationship with God apart from Christ. And so when you can share about the reality of God in your life, then you're going to be able to stoke, if you will, that jealousy. It's a good thing. We've been raised to say, don't make someone jealous intentionally, but that's God's way for Christians to practice Jewish evangelism.
David, this is so important because many Jewish people don't want a Bible thrown at them. You know, they don't want this. They don't want to be preached at. But if you have a supernatural story about how God changed your life or healed you, they're all ears.
Absolutely.
Susan, another point.
I would also add, with regard to answered prayer, is find an opportunity to offer to pray for answered prayer in the life of your Jewish friend. You know, they're going through a difficult time, maybe an illness, maybe a problem in their marriage or something with their children. Offer to pray and then let God do what God does and answer that prayer and see Him work in their lives.
That's another great point. David, how can we pray for Jews for Jesus? Susan, what's ahead? What are you working on now?
We're really excited about our brand new branch that's opening up in Haifa. And that's this
Fantastic.
Coming year's challenge for us. We're going to be having a Behold Your God Israel campaign in Haifa. This will be our seventh campaign in Israel where we're going out on the streets and handing out tracts. Please pray for our new work in Haifa and for the Behold Your God campaign coming up.
We will indeed. Thanks so much.
Thank you.
David Brickner and Sue Perlman. Just ahead, I'm going to be sharing some misconceptions that you may have about Jewish people and some they may have about you. We'll be right back.
These are the people that Jonathan Bernis and Jewish Voice are reaching by the thousands with desperately needed medical care and the good news of the gospel of Yeshua. And now you can do your part in reaching the largest population of Jewish people in the world, the American Jews. Do you know that believers are commanded to share the good news of salvation with the Jewish people? For your gift of $50 or more, Jonathan Bernis would like to send you his Jewish Outreach Kit, which will enable you to effectively share the gospel with your Jewish friend or neighbor. First, you will receive Jonathan's book on how to share Yeshua. In this book, Jonathan reveals the exciting revelation of God's call to share his son with the children of Abraham. Call now and you will also receive Jonathan's DVD on the 10 biggest lies about Jesus and his Jewishness, and a copy of A Rabbi Looks at Jesus of Nazareth. With warmth and transparency, Jonathan shares his journey of discovering Jesus and how it changed his life. Finally, for your gift of $50 or more, you will receive Moish and Seal Rosen's book, Witnessing to Jews, Practical Ways to Relate the Love of Jesus. Jews for Jesus founder Moish Rosen wrote this essential guide for witnessing to the Jewish people. So please pick up your phone or go online and give your most generous gift today.
This month, the month of November, and even into December, we have a very specific focus on the program, and that's telling your Jewish friends about Jesus. Now, why is this important? Each week I'll be giving you a different reason on why this is so important, but one is because of what the scripture tells us in Romans 11:11. In Romans 11:11, we're told that through the rejection of the Jewish people as a nation, the gospel has now come to the Gentiles to provoke the Jewish people to jealousy. How do we do that? How do you do that? How do you effectively share your faith with a Jewish person? Let me say this, first of all, that they're not in your life by accident. That Jewish coworker, that Jewish neighbor, that Jewish acquaintance is not there by accident. God wants you to be a light to them. So how do you share effectively with them? Well, the first thing I want to say is that you share with them the way that you share with anyone else. The Jewish person in many ways is no different than anyone else. First of all, we find out where a person is. When we want to be relevant in a person's life,
The Bible tells us that we should be relevant. We should be there for them. We should be able to give an answer to every person who asks. But in order to do that, to give an answer for what they ask, we have to listen. And that's why you have two ears and one mouth. Two ears, one mouth. Because we are to spend twice the amount of time listening as we are speaking. So when we're sharing our faith with anyone, when we want to be a light to anyone in anyone's life, we first need to get to know them. We need to find out where they're at. We need to become their friend. A mistake that believers often make is they begin to blurt out that a person needs Jesus, and this person doesn't even know if they believe in God. And so they have to believe in God before you can tell them that Jesus died for them. They have to realize or recognize that they have sin in their life before they realize or recognize that they need a sin bearer. So it's learning where they're at. It's being their friend. It's being there for them. This is not a drive-through experience, although occasionally we're given the opportunity to reap after the sowing's been done. Just yesterday, I was out in Old Phoenix and together with a friend led this artist to the Lord after we bought a picture from him, and he was ready. But for the most part, it's about a long-term, consistent relationship. It's about learning where they're at. It's about being there in their time of need. This is the case with my mother. I've been a believer 31 years, and my mother isn't yet ready to believe what I believe, but when she has a need, she calls us. She calls my wife in particular and says, would you pray? Because she knows that we have some line to the Lord, even though she doesn't believe. So being there for them consistently. So the same with a Jewish person as with a non-Jewish person. We develop a friendship. We learn to where they're at. We understand what their beliefs are, and we communicate with them. We have discussions based on where they're at, and we move them along. We move them along. Maybe at 1 year, they don't even know if God exists, and then something changes, and they begin to believe in God, and then you can take it to the next step. So something else to keep in mind, and this is something that I've came to realize decades ago, and the way that I approach Jewish people and all people when I share with them at an outreach, at a festival. And that is that every person, regardless of their background, regardless of their language, whether they're Jewish or not Jewish, has to deal with two questions in life. First, why am I here? What's my purpose for being here? And most people have a sense of destiny, a sense of purpose, and that's a great place to have a conversation. Why are you here on this earth? And then every person has to deal with death. Ultimately, every one of us will die. We have to face that reality. There's a joke that all of us have to pay taxes and all of us have to die, but I'm not sure about the taxes. But everyone has to deal with death. What is going to happen to you after you die? It's a very relevant issue for a Jewish friend or neighbor. They have to answer that question. Another thing that I really recommend is when you have the opportunity, share your testimony. Jewish people love stories. The most Jewish people that you talk to will be very open to hearing your testimony well before they're open to hearing the gospel, well before they want to hear what the Bible has to say. Can I tell you how God changed my life? And you'll find Jewish people very open to listening to that. Another thing that I strongly recommend is to tell that Jewish friend as you're in conversation that Jesus, your Savior, is their Messiah. Thank them for giving us, for giving you the Messiah, for giving you your Savior. Something else you can do is share with them out of their own scriptures. You don't need to use the New Testament. The disciples had only the Jewish scriptures, and they were able to expound out of their own scriptures what we call the Old Testament, that Yeshua, Jesus, was in fact the Messiah. And finally, one other thing, you need to pray. You need to pray, you need to pray, you need to pray. Pray for that Jewish person by name, that Jewish friend or coworker or neighbor by name. Pray for them daily. Ask God to open their eyes. Ask God to give you relevant things to say to them. And you will find that they will change because God answers prayer. I was told long ago by a well-known evangelist, it's God's job to open up a heart. Our job is to open our mouth, and that's so very true. So pray, 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 which is the most important single piece of advice I can give you when it comes to sharing your faith with Jewish people. The great news is Jewish people are coming to the Lord in greater numbers than any time since the first century. Recently, I led a team to Gondar, Ethiopia, to provide free dental care, medical and eye care, and most importantly, to share the good news of Jesus the Messiah. Hundreds came to know the Lord. Take a look.
She's thanking for those who
My foot were very swollen, but now it's getting better.
It's Thursday afternoon. I'm in Gondar, Ethiopia. This is our annual medical outreach, the Jewish Voice outreach, the medical outreach. And we happen to stumble upon this woman, and I don't know, you may remember from our footage from last year, this woman came to our clinic and seeking relief from the elephantitis that she suffers in her feet. And we gave her these shoes that you can see here a year ago, and you can see the wear and tear from trying to walk all around this city. The only way that she has to get around is by walking. And after 1 year, these shoes are just tattered and worn out and really just garbage. They're completely worn through on every level. One of our doctors found out about this story and literally took the shoes from her feet, off of her feet, and is gifting them to this woman to try to help her and relieve her suffering. So we're gonna give them to her now, and hopefully they'll last another year. But this is just another example of the amazing work that is done here through these outreaches, where people begin to rely on Jewish Voice as a way of bringing relief and help year after year, and how the community continually comes back to these outreaches for help. So these are for you, and God bless you.
The response in Gondar, Ethiopia was truly amazing. And that's why each time God opens a new door for us, we want to be able to respond and make a difference. Your help makes it possible for these incredible outreaches to continue, and as a result, transform literally tens of thousands of lives. Well, that's all the time that we have for today. So until next time, I want to remind you to pray for the peace of Jerusalem. The Bible says, "They shall prosper that love thee." For all of us here at Jewish Voice, this is Jonathan Bernis saying shalom and God bless you.
Remember, when you call today with your gift of $50 or more, Jonathan will send you his Jewish Outreach Kit. These are essential tools to help you reach your Jewish friends and neighbors with the good news of their Messiah Yeshua, Jesus. Your gift helps Jewish Voice continue to fulfill their promise to bring medical care and the message of the gospel to Jewish people worldwide. So please pick up your phone or go online and give your most generous gift today. Jewish Voice is made possible by the support of friends and partners like you.